Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Roar Within, Unleashing the Powerful Truth of Who You Really Are, by Brent Henderson. Narrated by Timothy Andrés Pabon. Introduction. The Roar Within. Oh, the power revealed the first time the lion cub roared and understood who he really was. One of the scariest nights I have ever spent was in a small fenced-in camp in Bululi, South Africa, on the southern banks of the Olifants River in Kruger National Park. At night, you can hear whole prides of lions roar. It's awesome. As the African sun began to set, the flickering glow of the campfire illuminated a wide circle. The shadows of the night crept in, and sparks drifted skyward. My tent was pitched just feet away from the edge of a barbed wire-topped chain-link fence, and I grilled hamburgers over the open flame. The intoxicating aroma of burning flesh cast a spell on man and beast for miles around as it swirled about and drifted into the night. When the final glimmer of daylight had melted away, the temperature dropped and blackness descended, as if I were sinking into the depths of the darkest sea. While I was finishing the last few bites of meat, something caused me to pause and squint past the glow of the fire into the shadows. I sensed something was locked onto me before I had visual recognition. It's an intimidating feeling. Through the fog of the night and the drifting smoke, there, only 20 feet away, a ghostly pair of yellow eyes 3 feet off the ground was staring straight at me. I was totally paralyzed. Silent fear set in as the hair stood up on the back of my neck. I could feel fight or flight begin to pump through my veins. Whatever had me in its sights was tracking my every move, and my eyes strained to uncover the predator blending into the night. Moments seemed like minutes. Then, all at once, the eerie shape of a large, spotted hyena materialized. It had smelled the meat and was moving in on its prey. The jaws of a hyena can crush the pelvis of a buffalo in one bite. Knowing I was its intended victim was no small thing. The hyena moved in my direction, only to pause and urinate against the fence just feet from my tent to mark its territory. It became a game. I moved to where it had urinated and marked my territory. Within minutes, it was back, reclaiming its territory. This game of dominance, with the hyena moving in and out of the shadows, continued for about 20 minutes, when suddenly, the hyena's body language changed from dominance to submission, as it cowered and disappeared into the dark. I thought I'd won our game of King of the Hill, until my ears picked up on the true cause of its turning. In the distance, but moving closer, I heard the unmistakable sound of a lion pride roaring, claiming its territory. A male lion is extremely protective of his home and family. He uses his roar to warn off anything that might threaten them. Male lions have been known to take down an animal weighing several thousand pounds and can eat the equivalent of 70 hamburgers in a single sitting. Their ferocious roars can be heard 5 miles away, and when the whole pride sounds off, every living creature stops what it's doing. They all know who the real king of the African plains is. The king is not a thief. He rules the plains, protects his pride, and takes what is his. Finding your one true voice. A lion's roar isn't something it earns from its father or from how many kills it achieves. That roar is something a lion is born with. It's imputed. The roar is given to the lion by the one who created it. This book is about helping you find your roar, your one true voice, the real you God placed in you the moment you truly believed, the you that is Christ in you, not the flesh and bones walking around, afraid, insecure, and full of worry and doubt, but the you from whom, when you live from that place, the enemy tucks tail and runs. We are embarking on a journey, a safari to help men understand the big question, am I enough? When you understand who you really are in Christ, you can live life to the full, the way that God intended. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. John chapter 10, verse 10. Are you ready to unleash the powerful truth of who you really are? Are you ready to discover and release the roar within? Then it's time to dress for battle and get your game face on. Let's do this. 1. The Big Question. The Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name. Exodus chapter 15, verse 3, New American Standard Bible. The dark, rolling waves crashed against our boat, slamming us into the side of the large scow we were tied up to, miles out in the open ocean of Bristol Bay, Alaska. Above the sounds of the smashing waves, I heard an argument breaking out on the deck of the scow. The voices were those of our captain and a deckhand from the larger scow, and things were getting out of hand quickly. As I was working to keep our boat steady, the captain's son was on a rope ladder above me, peering over the side of the scow to see what was causing this heated exchange. The next thing I knew, the son jumped off the rope ladder onto the deck of our boat, ran for the stern, opened a compartment below deck, and moments later burst out from behind the cabin door with a loaded AR-15. Several days before, there had been an altercation between our captain and this deckhand as we unloaded our catch onto this same scow. The deckhand's job was to weigh the 30 feet by 30 feet by 40 feet brailer bags full of salmon, each about 1,000 pounds, to know how much to pay us once we totaled the weight of all the bags. The problem was, the deckhand hadn't zeroed the scale and was trying to cheat us out of a lot of money. Salmon isn't cheap. When the salmon are running, sleeping even an hour or two is a luxury. Around-the-clock fishing for 5 days straight leaves everyone exhausted and on edge. Having to function at a high level with very little food or sleep, on dangerously cold, rolling seas, and smelling like a fishery gut pile, makes for short, nasty tempers. When fishermen come ashore after being at sea for days or weeks, trouble is a sure thing. These small fishing villages attract a lot of people who just don't fit in the lower 48, and a few who, like me, were just looking for an adventurous way to earn some money before the daily grind of college. For some of them, the wiring upstairs has a few faulty connections. Gambling, prostitution, heavy drinking, and illegal drugs were all there for the finding, and fights between these rough-cut hotheads were a given. When we had last been ashore, we'd gotten a burger at a hole in a wall called the Red Dog Saloon, and we heard that the night before a couple of coked-up guys got into a knife fight, resulting in one man losing an ear. This was not a place you wanted to take your kids. You took a large handgun instead. It didn't take much to light someone's fuse, and they were all too ready to strike the match. I guess I should clarify something. The devious deckhand wasn't a man. She was the roughest, smelliest woman I'd ever seen. I could only guess that when her ship made it to port, her shampoo of choice was Rogaine, and her wash rag was 40 grit sandpaper. She could outdrink a camel and was hairier than a muskox, meaner than a Cape buffalo, and more foul-mouthed than a turkey vulture. The reason my buddy had gone for the AR-15 was that he'd seen his dad shove this cheating deckhand hard onto the deck after she'd attempted to pull a knife on him. Before the mayhem escalated into shots being fired, the captain of the scow burst onto the deck, grabbed the deckhand, and escorted her to her quarters. The captain instructed us to leave to help defuse the situation, and also let us know that she was being fired and would be on the next supply ship headed to shore. On land or at sea, things in Alaska can go south quickly, and you'd better be able to handle yourself or you'll find yourself in a life-or-death situation on the count of one. Alaska isn't for sissies. Only those who are wild at heart can survive there. As crazy as that encounter was, I was strangely drawn to the new chapter of which I was now a part. It was almost as if I were taking the exam to get my man card, and I'd survived the first trial, at least as a character in a much larger story. I was being battle-tested, and something inside of me was beginning to step up. My boyhood question was being answered. Do I have what it takes to be a man? A man needs a much bigger orbit than a woman. He needs a mission, a life purpose, and he needs to know his name. Only then is he fit for a woman, for only then does he have something to invite her into. In John Eldridge's book, Wild at Heart, he states that all men need three key elements in their lives: a battle to fight, an adventure to live, and a beauty to rescue. When I first read the book in 2001, that message grabbed hold of me like nothing I'd ever heard. It wasn't churchy. It wasn't girly. It awakened the masculine in me the way that building forts, playing army or cowboys and Indians, and exploring the mountainside behind my house as a young boy had done. Most men I talk to who have read Wild at Heart say they felt the same way I did. Finally, a message for men that wasn't feminized, watered down, or politically correct, that gave men permission to be men. While attending a Wild at Heart men's conference in Colorado in 2004, I had a conversation with John Eldridge about purpose. I felt embarrassed as I shared, "John, I'm here because I've lost my heart. I'm 44 years old, and I'm not sure what I'm supposed to be doing with my life. I've always done what I thought everyone else thought I should be doing, but that pursuit has left me feeling like I'm just trying to please other people. I've lost the truest part of who I really am and what makes me come alive." I remember the next thing he said to me, because it moved me to my core in a way that nothing ever had before. He told me to stop asking myself what the world needed, but instead ask myself what made me come alive, because what the world needs is men who have come alive. When I was flying home from that conference, God spoke to me on the plane and told me that I would be his warrior poet. What did that mean? What was I supposed to do? How long would it take? That title would change my life forever, but it would be almost 10 more years before I would not only understand it, but believe it. Men ask the really deep questions when they are alone. Why am I here? Who am I really? What is my purpose in this life? Will I make a difference? My thoughts ran those circles as I sat alone for many hours on the deck of that Alaskan commercial fishing boat, keeping watch on the nets as massive schools of salmon made their way from the open ocean back to the streams where they were formed. They were headed there for one purpose: to give life to the next generation. There's an old Russian proverb, "If you chase two rabbits, you will not catch either one." When I heard it, it was like a punch in the gut, because that was me for many years. I'd chased so many rabbits, all of them good things, but I was almost no further along in getting my questions answered than when I'd begun chasing them many years before. Why? Because I had never been able to identify that one thing. I'd been living my life for the opinions of others. Once again, John's words pursued me. Ask yourself what makes you come alive. John had challenged me to ask and answer the big question: what makes me come alive? What was it that made me come alive like a lion on the prowl? I discovered it was fighting for the hearts of men, writing about the adventures God had planned for me to draw men to himself. I knew, because it roared inside me so loudly that I couldn't not do it. I was made to be his warrior poet. But almost as quickly as I heard the roar of God telling me who I truly was at my core and what I was meant to do, I learned the enemy wanted that roar, that purpose, silenced. He knew that if I ever truly lived out of that place where God made me fully alive, I would be dangerous. Just as God had a plan for me before I was born, the enemy had a plan to keep me from understanding my true identity. And dying in your beds many years from now, would you be willing to trade all the days from this day to that for one chance, just one chance, to come back here and tell our enemies that they may take our lives, but they'll never take our freedom? William Wallace, Braveheart. In my home office hangs a replica of the sword William Wallace carried in the movie Braveheart. It's the sword Wallace had slung across his back as he rode his horse back and forth in front of an army of his countrymen, and spoke to them when they were about to abandon their place on the front line out of fear. That speech is my favorite movie scene of all time. Whenever I watch it, something inside me wants to step up, to be a part of something larger than myself. Just holding that Scottish claymore in my hands gives me a feeling of power, strength, and purpose. When I brought the sword home and drew the 55-inch broad blade, double-edged sword from its leather sheath, for the first time, my 8-year-old son gasped, and his eyes widened as he asked, Dad, can I go out and hit some trees with that? That 8-year-old boy sensed that he was made for something larger than himself. It was instinctive for him to see if he could wield that mighty blade. Seeing my young son attempting to swing that sword that was as tall as he was stirred some very deep emotions in me. On one hand, I was proud. That's my boy. But the next emotion was one I didn't see coming. Fear. It rose from the pit of my stomach into my throat. I wasn't worried that he was going to hurt himself or damage the trees. This was something much deeper. I agonized over the question, do I have what it takes not only to teach my son how to wield this sword, but to help him fight the many battles he has yet to face, and to help him discover and pursue his purpose as he grows into a man? It was a fight or flight moment. Many men have fled in those moments, leaving their sons to try to figure out life for themselves. They were never trained how to raise their sons with a sense of purpose, or they'd been wounded too many times in battle, which left them feeling alone and abandoned. A boy who lacks the proper training, challenges, and encouragement as he grows into manhood will rarely find his purpose in life. He will end up settling for a mundane, mediocre life, losing his heart one day at a time. Or he will find himself getting into trouble, constantly trying to prove he's a man by affairs, drinking, or the pursuit of money and fame. Never being taught how to wield the sword brings about a slow, purposeless death, dragging on one day at a time until he is nothing but a dead man walking. Do you want to know God? Do you want to come alive? Do you want to know your purpose? Do you want to know your true name? Then you have to discover the roar within. They will walk after the Lord. He will roar like a lion. Indeed, he will roar, and his sons will come trembling from the west. Hosea chapter 11, verse 10, New American Standard Bible. The big question. What is that one thing that you just can't not do? The one thing that makes you feel truly alive? 2. Introducing the Big Five Man Killers. On the wild plains of Africa, you're on the menu. It's a savage land that will quickly propel all your senses to high alert, and off-the-hook adventures are sure to fit the bill. One excellent location for these exploits is Kruger National Park in South Africa. If you put in the time, you stand a good chance of seeing Africa's Big Five, and if you get too close, you could even become part of the Great Circle of Life. The Big Five are the rhinoceros, lion, Cape buffalo, elephant, and leopard. These man-killers are called the Big Five because of the difficulty in hunting them. They are five of the deadliest animals to walk the planet. Being a big game hunter, I have found myself in some pretty hairy situations on numerous occasions. When in the wilds, you have to remember that you are in their territory. You are constantly measuring each step, listening, smelling, feeling the wind's direction on your face, and watching for any movement. It's imperative to pay close attention at all times, as a lapse in any of those areas can alert game to your presence, causing them to either flee from you or try to eat you for lunch. This is where you have to bring your A game. And whether you realize it or not, everyday life is the same. I recently asked a trusted group of over 300 men to rate the top 5 struggles they deal with. I did this through a private, for men only, Facebook group I started, called Dangerous Men. One of the rules is that what is shared in the group stays in the group. If a member breaks the rule, he is removed from the group. Confidentiality is absolutely essential. Some of the men responded within my post, while others communicated with me privately, wanting to share their stories and explain why they put their struggles in a particular order. There are obviously more than 5 struggles men have, but of the ones I asked them about, here's how they rated them. I think you'll find it eye-opening. 1. Lack of purpose. 2. Lack of respect. 3. Anger. 4. Lust. 5. Shame. Next, I created an example of how each struggle can avalanche into the next. This may not be the same for you individually, but in staying true to the research, here is an illustration I believe most men will understand. When a man, 1, lacks purpose, He doesn't feel good about himself, so he craves respect from his wife, friends, boss, and or coworkers. If he perceives a 2, lack of respect, he becomes 3, angry. The anger can cause him to 4, lust, have affairs, look at porn, cuss, throw or hit things, or even quit his job. Those actions lead to 5, shame, which leads to more hiding or attempts at behavior modification. Realizing he can't conquer this on his own, can't manage his sin, he feels more shame, which eventually leads to more sin. Wash, rinse, repeat. We struggle when we start comparing ourselves to others. This can create deep isolation as it leads to low self-worth. The only answer to these struggles is when a man realizes that his worth and value will never come through what he did or didn't accomplish, whether he has others' respect or whether he did or didn't sin. A man's identity in Christ will never come through his performance, but only through Christ in him, which is something he cannot earn. It is a gift. God put his righteousness, his good enough, in the believer the moment he truly believed. And that, my friend, is enough to take down any man killer. We're going to assign one of the big 5 deadly man killers of the African plains to each of the big 5 man killers men struggle with on the home front. These are the deadliest lies that stalk a man and want to destroy his heart. As we continue on our journey, we'll identify these man killers and learn how to stop them in their tracks. 3. The Big 5 Man Killers, number 1. Lack of purpose. Rhinoceros. Rhinos live a very isolated life. They are not social. They're solitary creatures. Their visual field reaches only about 25 feet, so they're not distracted by things they see. They go to the bathroom in the same spot, creating a dung pile the size of a Volkswagen, and they alternate between feeding and resting through the day and night. During the rare times when they aren't eating or sleeping, you'll find them getting a cool mud soak, their spa treatment. Rhinos have no desire to do anything but eat, unless something threatens their safety. Several years ago, an African veterinarian was sedating rhinos so that they could be examined and given vaccinations if needed. After a tranquilizer dart hit a 4,000-pound rhino, the rhino quickly became irritated. The vet ran, thinking he'd been identified by the rhino as the source of that shot in the butt. Big mistake. The rhino came at him like a bulldozer. As the vet tried to escape, the rhino dropped its head between the man's legs, and before he could jump out of the way, the rhino raised its head with so much force that the horn went clear through the vet's thigh as he was lifted off the ground. Then, lifting the 225-pound man off the ground again, the rhino tossed him back onto its second horn like a sack of potatoes, snapping his spine. As if that wasn't enough torture, the rhino then tossed the vet into the air like a rag doll while going through a thicket of acacia thorn trees. The thorns of the acacia are as long as your finger and as sharp as a hypodermic needle. Before his body could hit the ground, the vet was skewered by thorns and was suspended face up until his partner could cut him out. After using the tools in their medical kit to close the gaping hole in his thigh, his partner called in a chopper to get him to safety. In a heartbeat, that lethargic, bored beast had become a man killer. Lack of purpose, like the rhino, is a two-horned killer. It can manifest itself through lethargy or through acting out. In some, lack of purpose can look like laziness, causing a man to lose focus, shut down, or unplug from life and relationships. He may start sleeping excessively or suffer with feelings of depression. Lack of purpose can also cause a man to get caught up in something that makes him feel alive but is not good for him. Overworking, overeating, excessive gaming, and taking risks to get that adrenaline rush, giving in to sexual temptation, and so on. Lack of purpose always plays on a man's thoughts, making him believe he's not good enough. That belief can drive a man to sin. Sin always has an immediate payoff when we're feeling down. That's why it's so attractive. The problem is that it leaves us feeling even more worthless. When a man lacks purpose and direction, he will not feel valued. This plays havoc with his psyche, causing him to wonder why he's here. In the movie First Blood, a decorated Vietnam War hero, John Rambo, struggles to find his purpose after the war. He becomes an antisocial drifter, unable to cope with the loss of the life, friends, and purpose he once knew. In one of the opening scenes, he's mistreated and talked down to by the local sheriff, who tells him that this community doesn't want drifters like Rambo in their town. He insults Rambo by mocking the way he looks while having the American flag on his jacket, the flag of the country Rambo had been willing to give his life to defend. He then tells Rambo that he wouldn't like it there because the town is boring, and proceeds to escort him to the outskirts of town to keep Rambo from being a part of that safe little community. It was the peace and freedom of these little towns that Rambo had fought to protect. During the war, he had discovered a purpose larger than his own life to give himself to. Now, the very ones he fought for were labeling him a drifter and telling him he wasn't good enough. One of the most gut-wrenching and powerful scenes is the end of the movie. Rambo is surrounded by hundreds of law enforcement officers attempting to either kill him or take him into custody when his commanding officer from the war shows up and attempts to de-escalate the conflict. He reminds Rambo that he had once been a part of an elite group and begs him not to let it end this way. Being reminded that he'd once been part of something special triggers a volatile response Rambo has been holding inside for years. Back there, I could drive a gunship. I could drive a tank. I was in charge of million-dollar equipment. Back here, I can't even hold a job parking cars. The next thing you see is Rambo collapsing onto the floor, sobbing as he remembers. This once elite warrior was now lying on the ground, lost, purposeless. Let's look again at William Wallace's speech. And dying in your beds many years from now, would you be willing to trade all the days from this day to that for one chance, just one chance, to come back here and tell our enemies that they may take our lives, but they'll never take our freedom? What was it about this speech that moved men who were about to cut and run to pick up their weapons and charge the enemy? Purpose. When Wallace rode in on his horse, face painted for war, claymore at the ready, his voice full of passion and his words like a double-edged sword slicing apart the lies the men had unknowingly believed, something extremely powerful happened. There was a mighty turning of the tide. These men let out a mighty roar from a place deep within, a roar that had been waiting for such a time as this to be called up. They were ready to answer the question, "Do I have what it takes?" Their purpose had been awakened, and these men were ready to give their lives for something greater than themselves. In the introduction, I shared how when the lion roared that night in Baluli, the hyena cowered and ran because it knew what that lion was capable of doing. Why then do so many men run from their calling or duty and head into the shadowy places when the Lion of Judah is on their side? Purposelessness. When a man loses his sense of purpose, he feels like he is not enough, like he's in an endless bank of fog, alone, helpless and hopeless, and he'll run from the very battles and challenges he was designed to overcome. Lack of purpose is the number one man killer all men face. A man's purpose isn't man-made, it comes from God. What man didn't give, man can't take away. The only one whose opinion matters is God, period. Because of God's gift of grace, a man doesn't have to dutifully or anxiously perform to please God. Creating our own purpose in an attempt to please God or others takes us away from what God wants and puts us in the place of being our own master. Surrendering our lives to God allows us to joyfully and peacefully participate in the purpose He's planned for each of us. This purpose is not found through performance, achievement, recognition, or respect. Our true purpose can only be found through total surrender to God's purpose for us. That begins to happen when we start believing God is who He says He is, and we are who God says we are. When you take away a man's purpose, you've taken away his passion, his will to live, his identity. The problem occurs when we believe our purpose comes from what we do or what others think of us. That belief leads a man to take his "Do I have what it takes?" question to the wrong place. Where does he go with this question? To his performance and other people's opinions. When he fears not being enough. He will create an elaborate mask, displaying a false self to attempt to prove he's good enough. The big question. Where in your life do you find you're most tempted to put on the mask? And why? 4. Finding your swing. Inside each and every one of us is our one true authentic swing, something we was born with, something that's ours and ours alone, something that can't be learned, something that's got to be remembered. The Legend of Bagger Vance. The Legend of Bagger Vance is the story of a golfer from Savannah, Georgia. Young golf hero Ranolph Juna, played by Matt Damon, is a prodigy who by the age of 16 is well on his way to becoming one of the most famous names in golf. Then World War I breaks out. Juna enlists in the army and is soon shipped off to Europe, leaving his giftedness behind to fight in a horrible war. He comes out with a Medal of Honor, but since everyone else in his regiment is killed, he also comes out with a minefield of unhealthy thoughts from the horrors he experienced. Upon returning home, he discovers he's not only lost his friends and his girl, he's also lost his desire to ever again play the game he loved. Instead of picking up where he left off before the war, Juna retires to an old farmhouse, where he sinks into a mire of heavy drinking, smoking, and gambling with guys who've lost their hearts as well, and essentially gives up on life. During one such evening of drinking and gambling, a young boy named Hardy Greaves walks through the door in search of this golfer his father had once told him about, the best golfer he'd ever seen. The local golf course is putting on a tournament with a winning prize of $10,000. They've invited the two best golfers of the day, Bobby Jones and Walter Hagen, but a third player is required to complete the roster, and it must be a native of Savannah. The young boy thinks that bringing in Juna would be their best hope of putting Savannah on the map. No one knows where Juna is, but the persistent Hardy finds him, a little drunk, in a smoke-filled room, just a shell of a man. When Juna asks Hardy what brings him here, the boy says maybe he should come back when Juna's not so busy. Juna replies, "I thought you were going to say drunk," and informs the boy that there's not enough alcohol in the entire state to get him drunk enough. When Hardy asks him how drunk is drunk enough, Juna replies that it's all a matter of brain cells. Every drink of liquor you take kills 1,000 brain cells. First, the sadness cells die, so you smile real big. Then the quiet cells go, so you just say everything real loud for no reason at all. That's okay, because the stupid cells go next, so everything you say is real smart. And finally come the memory cells. These are tough to kill. Just about anything, alcohol, food, drugs, sex, work, exercise, or even attending church, can become the means to kill our memory cells. If we can't atone for our sins by being religious enough, performance, we'll cultivate an addiction to bury them deep within. The big lie. One thing I know from working with people with alcohol problems is that they usually aren't drinking to get drunk for no reason. If you listen closely to what they're saying, the more they drink, there's deep-seated pain buried far below the plastic exterior they are trying so hard to maintain. This pain has silenced more than a few good men. You might think the pain that begins to come out is from the loss of a job or a loved one or from a broken relationship. And if you look no deeper into what they're saying, then you'll think that's as deep as it goes, and that's exactly what the enemy wants. He doesn't want you digging any deeper, because if you do, you will see past his deception of blaming self or blaming others, and get down to what's really happening. Satan is the one who is to blame. Let me untangle that a bit. The Bible teaches in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, that we are made up of three parts, body, soul, and spirit. Our body is our flesh. It's what we can see. Our soul, contrary to popular belief, is not the eternal part of us, but rather where our thoughts, will, and emotions are formed. Our spirit is the eternal part of us. That's the part of us the enemy can't touch once we're believers. The moment you truly believe and receive Christ as Lord and Savior, God's promised Holy Spirit comes into your spirit and dwells within you. That means that, at your core, you are 100% complete in Him. God is the one who completes you and gives you your true worth and value. But the enemy doesn't want you to know that. If you could actually grasp this powerful truth, if this truth were to penetrate to the core of your being, it would radically change your life. Satan knows that and will do all he can to stop that from happening. So how does the enemy keep us there? Here's his biggest lie. Your performance plus others' opinions equals your self-worth. Satan traps you into believing that your good enough comes from your performance. He can do this by making you believe that if something difficult happens, for example, the loss of a job or relationship, you're a worthless loser. But he can take the opposite tack as well, convincing you that if something good happens, say you get a promotion at work, this makes you great and better than others who are now worthless losers. This is how the enemy eats you for lunch, swallowing you whole over and over and over again. If Satan can deceive you into believing your worth comes from others' opinions, with thoughts like, if I were more of a man, she'd have sex with me more often, or if I were more of a man, she wouldn't have left me, he has you in the bag. Another lie is, if I were bigger or tougher or more important, men would respect me more. Or the lie may come through loss. I'm divorced. No one will ever love me again. That's another one of his cognitive distortions, called an all-or-nothing statement. If you buy into these lies, he'll chew you up and spit you out covered in the slime of depression and shame, leaving you seeking ways to deaden the pain through addictions or religion. Jonah's drug of choice was alcohol, which was probably the more honest of the two. At first, Jonah does everything he can to dissuade Hardy's attempts to convert him, but the boy is relentless. Jonah turns young Hardy away, but something in the boy's belief in him reawakens a place deep in his soul, a place he thought was lost, forgotten, a place he'd buried when his get-up-and-go got up and went after the war. But now a new war is raging. Jonah's battle is now an internal one to once again believe in who he really is. The dark of night finds Jonah outside of his house, alone with just a lantern and his golf clubs. As Jonah is hitting balls everywhere but straight, a stranger, played by Will Smith, mysteriously appears directly in front of him, like a ghost in the darkness. Jonah tells the man he could have killed him, and the man answers that with the shots Jonah was making, right in front of him was the safest place. At first, Jonah is taken aback by the boldness and truthfulness of this man, Bagger, whom he's never seen before. The two men begin to talk, and Bagger offers to be Jonah's caddy for the upcoming Savannah tournament, with Bagger's cut being only the guarantee of $5. Bagger sees something deeper than slices, hooks, and missed opportunities, and it's unsettling to Jonah. Suspicious, he thinks. Yeah, right. What's the catch? Embarrassed and angry that this stranger has been watching him hit one bad shot after another, he hands Bagger a club and tells him to hit a ball. Bagger crushes a shot into the darkness, leaving Jonah dumbfounded and sullen. Jonah is not just frustrated by the fact that this guy is striking the ball better and farther than he is. He's puzzled that this total stranger wants to come alongside him to help him get his swing back, and for a guarantee of just $5. When Bagger tells Jonah that the trick is to find his swing, a dumbfounded Jonah asks, "What'd you say?" As Bagger smiles and kneels to tee up another golf ball, he looks up at Jonah and simply tells him that he's lost his swing and that they need to go find it. When Jonah uttered the words, "What'd you say?" the look on his face was as if someone had just turned the key to the core of his being, like he'd been seen for the very first time without flaw, without sin, without shame, forgiven. Years ago, someone told me that if we invest in others, if we add value to them, we build trust. We draw others to us. And that's exactly what Bagger was doing. Bagger came just for Jonah, as if it were a divine appointment from a higher power. It's like the way the Holy Spirit comes alongside each believer. Sometimes all it takes for a man to find his swing, to find his roar again, is for someone to come alongside him and remind him who he really is and what he's capable of when he ditches the lies and replaces them with truth. Unfortunately, many men take their swing to a woman to get their affirmation or hide in shame, feeling like they're not good enough for her. Men also do this when they compare themselves to other men, leaving them feeling either more prideful or more pitiful than they should. Comparison is a losing game. After the war, Juna had retreated to his home and put himself in solitary confinement. He hid not only from the game he'd loved, but from Adele, the woman he loved. The tournament in which Juna eventually agreed to play had been Adele's idea. She was hosting the event, hoping to revive both Savannah, Georgia, and her late father's golf resort. The tournament begins. After the first round, Juna's fallen far behind the leaders. It's so embarrassing he's ready to quit and walk away. He's allowing everything around him to keep him from playing his game. Juna watches his competitors connect with their shots, leaving the crowd in awe, and he's losing strokes on every hole as he begins to compare himself with them. Bobby Jones, the good-looking golfer with the perfect hair and swing, has won national championships, British Opens, and a Grand Slam.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.